Okay, let us start again. So I've drawn on the board our first circuit. So remember, this is basically based on the C1 circuit, the fixed bias we saw last week. I've effectively redrawn it here a bit, slightly, you know, in a different way to show you now how on that circuit I can introduce small AC signals. So if you remove this part here, you see this is the RB resistor that was connected to the base with some voltage applied to that. So this is all DC, as you can see. This is the power supply that was attached to the collector resistor and so on. So if you remove these parts here, this is effectively what we saw last week as C1 fixed bias. What I've done now is I've added this part, for example. So this is my small signal input, and I've connected it to the circuit. What I want is that this AC signal becomes superimposed to the existing DC bias without altering things. And the way I do it is through a capacitor. The capacitor is extremely important in this situation because this capacitor is blocking the DC from coming this side of the circuit, but is allowing the AC to go through. So basically in this part, you have AC together with DC. Same story there. So this capacitor here is very important to be able to extract from my circuit only the AC part. This capacitor is blocking any DC component. DC can be transferred through the capacitor. We've discussed this thing, I think it was the first or the second lecture, when we were dealing with the passive components, fundamental passive component. So only AC can travel through this capacitor, and so really here I can only see the AC part of whatever is here. We call that Vout, according to our two-port model in common emitter configuration. So you can see that this is common emitter, is the first one we dealt with. So this is how it would look like, this circuit, this amplifier, containing both all the components that will allow it to operate at a specific quiescent point. You see, all these parts are related to letting it operate at a specific point. But then on top of that, we've added the AC, clearly AC related parts. And so now the question is, how does this behave as an AC amplifier? So if I was to ask you, let's say I give you this circuit and I ask you, define the DC biasing condition of this circuit, find the quiescent point, blah, 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 like we did last week. In DC, if you want to analyze, so you want to do the DC analysis of the circuit, what do you do? Well, in DC, the capacitor, as we said, the capacitor doesn't let through DC. So this means that whatever is beyond the capacitor, we don't even consider, it doesn't exist. Same here. So effectively, when you are asked to perform the DC analysis of something like that, you say, I consider the capacitors as open circuits. And so you drop everything that is beyond that. So this means that for the DC analysis, the circuit I need to deal with is what we saw last week. Let me redraw it using, you know, what is here now. So it would be V, what we call there as V in, like that, the DC, these. I'm exaggerating here, doing also for these DC generators, you know, drawing them accurately and so on. So we will then just put the label, okay? I'm just doing it now to be clear. So this is effectively the circuit we dealt with last week, if you remember. We had drawn the RB horizontal, but it's the same. So DC analysis means I look at this. I've dropped everything that is open circuit. Eh? This is an open circuit in DC. This is an open circuit. We forget about that. We analyze this. We know how to analyze this. We did it last week. So through the analysis of this thing, I will be able to define properly RB, for example, RC, depending what you have to do, define IC, define IB, whatever, DC part. Okay, let's say this is done. I'll forget about this. We know how to deal with that part. Now the question is, let's deal now with the AC analysis. When I'm asked to do the AC analysis, I should forget about everything that is DC. So this means if you generators that are clearly DC must be removed from the circuit. Now removed carefully. We use the things that we've discussed now probably some time ago with Thevenin as well. How do we remove generators from a circuit? Well, the voltage generators must be shorted, current generators must be open circuited. So in this case I have two voltage generators. So for the AC analysis of that circuit I need to short these two. One additional thing that we will do, because that's what makes sense doing, is we will do the assumption that all the capacitors that we have put in for the reasons we discussed, the values of the capacitance that we've chosen are such that for the frequency at which this amplifier will be operating, effectively the impedance of, for example, this capacitor and that capacitor are negligible, like 0 ohm, or very, very small, compared to other, we will discuss this a bit more in detail later, but, so my point is, when we will go and deal with the AC analysis of the circuit, you are allowed to make this assumption. Let us assume that I've chosen these two in such a way that at the frequency I will be operating the amplifier, their impedances are effectively zero or near to zero or negligible anyway. So I'm allowed to replace them with a short. Okay? So let me redraw the circuit based on the thing we've said. Short the DC generators and also short under these assumptions the capacitors that are present. So for the AC analysis, the circuit I need to deal with is this one. You see that RB now will be going to ground. So let me draw it. Eventually here we will attach our load, we'll see later. So you see that already the circuit has been simplified a lot. Now I need to replace my nonlinear element with the model, our simplified model. So let me remember the simplified model. I shall put it maybe here, just so we have it always in front of us. This is B, this is E, this is E, this is C. And IC goes like that. So if I want now to replace this model into there, what I will draw is the following thing. So this is B, this is E, and this is C. So this is B. So you can see that between B and D, I've replaced the input port, which is effectively just that part. Now, out beyond the C and D, so I've then drawn the C, the output port, which was this one. And beyond C and D, what I see is RC toward ground, connected to C, toward ground. Remember, the emitter is a ground, so ground is here. RB also, you see the RB is going to C, to ground. So I believe that's the circuit. This is HFEIB. This is IB, is this current here, IB tilde. IC is this current here, IC tilde. Okay, so we could name some currents here. I will try to do in full details the analysis of this circuit. We will see that the other configurations are effectively, they end up to be exactly the same. So there is no need to go then in details and do the exactly the same analysis. We will do it once now. So let me put the names of the currents. This will be called IRB, so I won't write it there, otherwise it becomes a mess. This is I in with a tilde on, and what else do we have? This will be IRC, and this will be I out. So what we can write for the input port is that IB, IB, which is the current here, I see there are two resistors in parallel, isn't it? So one thing you can write is that as we've seen the voltage divider for when you have two resistors in series. Two resistors in parallel form what we call the current divider, and that's what we have. So I could use the result already know from the current divider to write that IB is AB over but IB is also IB is, you see, this is VB, VBE. And so IB is VBE over HIE also. or Vin, sorry, let's use Vin because we are using Vin now. So this is for the input port. For the output, let me write it here. We have that we can use KCL, so Kirchhoff current law at this node. You see that these three currents, IC plus IRC plus Iout must be zero. And we should also remember that because of the what we know from the model, IC is HFE IB. It's already written here. IC is determined completely by this generator, which is HFE IB. Okay, so IC is HFE IB, and according to that, to the KCL, this is actually minus I out minus IRC. And we should remember that if I don't attach RL, I out will be zero. Eh? Remember, if there is nothing attached to it, there is no I-out. I-out will be zero. If RL was attached, this would be V-out over RL. And this IRC is equal to V-out divided by RC. I'm just writing down all the equations, all the important relations that come out from this circuit. And now we can focus on analyzing four important quantities that are important for an amplifier, for any amplifier. These four quantities are, I will write them here, in general are the input impedance or resistance, more general impedance, the voltage gain, the current gain, and the output impedance. So, what is the input impedance? The concept of input impedance is related to, if I have a circuit, two terminals that I can attach to with a generator, the concept of input impedance is the concept that allow me, if I knew the input impedance of that circuit I'm attaching to, would allow me to realize if it was a voltage supply that I was attaching to that, to realize how much current is going to be drawn into these two terminals. That's where the concept of the input impedance come from. So if I have a circuit with two terminals that are waiting for me to attach my generator to, the question is, so the idea is that whatever complex is the circuit, I can always imagine that this will have some certain resistance, equivalent resistance, an input resistance. Then this will determine if I attach here my power supply or whatever, the current that is effectively drawn into the circuit. Okay, this relates to, you can think of this concept related to what we did with Thevenin, equivalent circuits that effectively represent the overall behavior of a complex, even more complex circuit. So, for my circuit here, the input impedance, Z input, let's use the term of impedance because it's more general, is V input, based on what we just said, over the input current. Uh, we can actually find this relation from these two equalities here. You can see that I can easily bring this term IN here, HIE on the other side, and this is VIN over IN, which is exactly the same input. And I realize that the VIN over IN is actually RB time HIE over RB plus HIE. But this is what would result from doing the parallel between RB and HIE. So the input impedance of the circuit is the parallel of these two. Is it surprising? No. If I look at this circuit from here, I see RB in parallel to HIE. We are discovering the... But simply, you see now in the framework, you know, beautiful sentences and so on and so forth. But that's what we see did. Then let's move on to the voltage gain. So I will write here just to remember, Z in is RB in parallel to HI. So the voltage gain, we need to distinguish if RL is attached or not. We know that when I attach something to a circuit, it will perturb the circuit. So let's not attach that yet. If it's not attached, what I'm about to calculate is what I would call AV, the voltage amplification infinite. Infinite means RL is infinite, which means open circuit, not connected. Okay. In this sense, I write it as AV infinite. So AV infinite is V out, tilde, sorry, over V in. That's the definition of voltage amplification. So, V out is, I can't look at this because this is true only if IRL is connected. I need to look at this one. V out is, okay, we need to think about something. When RL is infinite, I was trying to jump some steps, but I need to do it more carefully. So RL is plus infinite, is not connected. I out is zero. So going back to KCL, this means that IC is minus IRC. So this means that effectively this current here is minus, effectively this current is flowing there, okay? This current, just because it's going in the other direction, the direction I've taken. Okay, so these currents are the same. The same except the sign. So V out is RC time IRC, isn't it? Is RC time IRC over V in. IRC, we just demonstrated that is minus IC. So this is minus RC IC tilde over V in. IC is HFEIB, I'll continue here, minus RC HFEIB. IB is V in over HIE. You've done your first amplifier. This is a voltage amplifier. with an amplification factor. This is AV infinite. As we said, we are not still attaching anything to it. You're just, let's say, measuring the voltage that is you are seeing in output. The amplification is HFE over HEI time RC. Is the negative sign is there to remind you that actually there is a different phase between the output and the input. Minus means a different phase of 180 degrees. So in other words, if this was the input, the output will look something like this. 180 degrees different in phase. Okay? So AV infinite is minus RC HFE over HIE. Remember, HIE is of the order of a kilo ohm. All the RCs we probably come across are also of the order of a kilo ohm. So really, all the designs we've seen up until now have an amplification factor in voltage that is effectively HFE, which is 100. So this amplifies around, I mean, if RC, depends, all depends on RC, but if RC is on the order of a kilo ohm, this will amplify at 100, okay? So this is the voltage amplification without RL attached. If we now attach RL, what will I expect is that now RL is in parallel to RC. So I've done all the whole derivation, the whole demonstration, but when there was no RL, RC ended up there. Will you believe me that if I attach RL here, we need to put the parallel between RL and RC? Because they are effectively in parallel. Huh? Is that a reasonable shortcut that I can take? The full explanation anyway is here. It's just algebra. So I will avoid doing the full derivation here, but I can give you the final result, which is RC parallel RL time HFE over HIE. But the nice thing now to notice is that let me write this voltage amplification in terms of AV infinite when there were no RL attached, so that we can fully grasp the effect of attaching something, my load, to my amplifier. Imagine that you wanted, I made an amplifier that amplifies 100 times, and now I will be able to lit up my LED with starting from a very small signal, and you're attaching it there, my load, my LED, and so on and so on. And suddenly, nothing happens. This is because the load affects the amplification. So let's put that more explicit, into highlight it. The way is extremely simple. You just need to explicitly write down this term. This is, if you explicitly expand it, is this. And the AV infinite was RC minus RC HFE, blah, blah, blah. So this could be written as AV infinite time RL. As you can see, this quantity, AV infinite time something that is always smaller than one. So this means whatever you attach to the circuit, at most this will be very close to one. If RL is much bigger than RC. So AV is roughly AV infinite if RL is much bigger than RC. So if you are attaching a very big load. Otherwise, if you were attaching something that has a very small load, then you would be in trouble. Because this term, if RL is small, RC dominates, and RL is small, RC dominates is big, this is very small. And you are decreasing enormously the total amplification of the circuit. Okay, and finally, let's have a look now at the current gain. So I will need to remove some stuff. Let me put it here that AV is AV infinite when we attach RL. Is AV infinite time RL over RL plus RC. And now the current gain, which we indicate by AI, or talking about the current gain is only meaningful once you attach the load. Otherwise, there is no current, I out. So this is the case when you want to use this circuit to draw some current into something, a solenoid, a relay. We'll see next week some nice applications of these things. So AI is the current amplification is the output current divided by the input current. So what is it? From this KCL, we can replace I out with minus IRC minus IRC minus IC minus IRC over I in. And IRC is V out over RC. IRC, the current through here is V out over RC. So I can continue here. And also, I will replace IC is HFE IB, and IB is V in over HIE. So I will do all this replacing in one go. So this is minus HFE V in over HIE minus V out over RC yes actually V out also V out we have attached RL V out is AV time V in this is the definition of AV AV was V out over V in so V out could be replaced with AV the AV when I touch RL, time V in. So I will do that. And down here, I in, did I write it anywhere? I in, I could, how much is the current in input? Is V divided by the total resistance here, which we call Z in, isn't it? It's the parallel of these two. So I in, I will replace it with V in divided by Z in, which is RB parallel HI. So there is some algebra here to do. I need to replace, you know, AV and so on and so forth. There is no reason to spend time and, you know, I've done all the steps here. So I will not do all the steps in here. But what really matters is that in the end, if you do all these substitutions, you see in the end, everywhere you have V in, so you can simplify V in. And you're left with only, you know, constants and terms. And so in the end, you get the final result is minus HFE RB over RB plus HIE time RC over RL plus RC. And so what we see is that the current amplification, so this is really cool. This circuit can behave as a voltage amplifier, but now this can also behave as a strong current amplifier. Well, how strong really depends on RB and RC and RL and all the rest. Indeed, this is roughly minus HFE if RB dominates, so RB is much bigger than HIE, and also RC is much bigger than RL. So the load is small. That's kind of intuitive, isn't it? If RC, previously we said, if RL is much bigger than RC, the circuit behaves as a very good voltage amplifier because AV becomes equal to AV infinite. And now we find that the circuit behaves as a very good current amplifier with a very large amplification, HFE, when instead the load is smaller than RC. So for large load, it works like a very good voltage amplifier. For small load, like a very good current amplifier. What do you think? It's cool, isn't it? With the same circuit, just depending on what you want, you can get a lot of things, different things. It's really cool. Finally, the concept of output impedance. So we got these three output impedance. So the concept of output impedance is equivalent in a way to input impedance. The only, let's say, tricky part in imagining that is that you need to kind of have in order to define it, you need to do an abstract step, let's say, that is, let us imagine that I wanted to apply a generator on the output. What would be the current flowing into the circuit? As you did for the defining the input impedance, the same here. The only thing is that you need to imagine that there is no input. So let's imagine that there is no input. This means IB is zero. And so this means that this is zero. A current generator that is zero means open circuit, effectively. Nothing can pass through here. If nothing can pass through here, it's like it doesn't exist. And so if I'm looking on this part of the circuit and I'm asking, the impedance I see? It's RC. So the output impedance of this circuit is RC. Okay. So this is for this completes the analysis, the AC analysis of my C1 fixed bias common emitter configuration. And so we've seen all the important parts: input impedance, output impedance, current amplification, voltage amplification. So you can see also that, I mean, there is some algebra here and there, but in the end, you know, thanks to this extremely simple circuit, I mean, we are doing something very cool here. Eh? An amplifier that can amplify voltage at least 100 times and current also 100 times. So, you know, in a few steps, we got to something very remarkable, I would say. Let me quickly go through C2 and C3 quickly because, as I anticipated, the results are exactly the same. I will show you briefly in a moment. So let's talk about C2. C2 that was called emitter bias. in the emitter, emitter bias. So in the emitter bias, if you remember, we were adding a resistor here. This was to improve the stability of the circuit, if you remember. Now, if I am to leave that like that, this would complicate the AC analysis. So what we do here, we add the circuit we will deal with always will have a capacitor here. This is a capacitor that is there to make sure, like those, that when you do the assumption, as we said previously, let us assume that the frequency you will be dealing with is such that this impedance is effectively zero or negligible. This means that the effect of this capacitor is actually to short array. So when I go and analyze the circuit in AC, this resistor doesn't exist. It's a very clever trick to simplify things. That's what we will do. I mean, these are the kind of circuit we will be dealing with. Okay, this just to keep things simple. So you understand that the DC, so if I ask, okay, do the DC analysis of this circuit, obviously this capacitor doesn't exist. This doesn't exist, this doesn't exist, and so we get to analyze the circuit we saw last week, okay? But when you are now asked, do they now, you've done the DC analysis, do now the AC analysis. With the AC analysis, this must become a short. If this becomes a short, RE doesn't exist. This is called bypass, common emitter with emitter bias and bypass RE, if you like. But we don't say it. We assume that that's the situation. Okay, so we will always be dealing with that. And so you understand that this circuit always also represents the AC analysis of that. Okay, it's exactly the same. So the AC equivalent of this is again that. So everything stays the same. Same formula, same everything. Isn't that cool? Yeah. So we have a better, more stable amplifier, BJT. The DC biasing of this system is better because RE is there. But the AC analysis is the one we've just seen. Very simple. So finally, the third case, so there is no reason obviously to say more, is the same. And the third case we had seen was the best, we said, of the three, was the voltage divider. The voltage divider was let me remove these generators here because they are causing just mess. So let's put a label. And this was, let's say, VCC. So this was the voltage divider configuration. We will keep RE with that capacitor. Again, same trick to make sure that it's not there in the end. So DC analysis, we've seen the DC, the voltage divider last week. Again, remove this capacitor, remove this stuff, remove that stuff, and everything that is left, we've seen how to deal with that last week. When we come and do the AC analysis of this, well, the only thing that happens as compared to that is that now we have R1 and R2 instead of RB. R1 is connected to VCC here, but when we do the AC analysis, we said we need to short the DC voltage generator. So this is ground now in AC, and so R1 goes to ground as well. So I need to replace RB Because R1 and R2 now will be in parallel. R1 has to, goes to ground as well. So R1 now, it would be here. R1 and R2, they are in parallel. So effectively I'm replacing R1 and RB with R1 and R2 that are in parallel. And so I can, that's the beauty of these three seen together, is that now I can use again the same stuff we've seen until now, just replace RB with R1, R2. Did I convince you that here R1 and R2 are in parallel? Let me draw it properly. So R2 would be, is ready to work ground. We said when you do the AC analysis, you need to replace the voltage generator with the ground. So this is, will become ground here. So R1 goes from this point to ground. So I should draw it here like that. This ground, this line is ground. So this is R1. R1, R2, these are in parallel. And so this means you can just, they take the place of what previously was RB. And so you can use exactly the same results, simply replace RB with R1, R2. And that's the end of this. So you, here today we've seen the three. Last week we've done the DC analysis of these three circuits, and now we've also seen the corresponding AC counterpart and how they behave as AC amplifiers. This is the first day that we have done effectively everything that was really important to say. So today I will do in the post-lecture video, I will just put some, let's say, things for you, curiosities. Okay, it's basically what happens if I don't put C, and a few words about how does this thing behave, this amplifier behave overall in frequency. What's the frequency response? It won't be the same at all frequencies, but there will be a bandwidth, okay, where this works. And I will give you some explanations, very simple. It's all about RC circuits, our filters. So you will see that there. Okay, but I'm happy that today we did all the parts that were very important in class. Okay, so I'll see next week. Next week is the last lecture. We will do effectively applications of all these filters and the exercises, possibly. So we will have some fun, hopefully. So I'll see you next week.